Good morning.
Good morning.
Welcome to the AWS studio.
Thank you. Excited to be here.
Why don't you introduce yourself?
My name is Amir Krispin. I'm from the product management team at HCL Software.
And tell us a little bit more about HCL Software.
Yeah, so HCL Software is a separate business unit inside the well-familiar HCL. And we are a product-based company. We have all verticals that challenges telcos specifically, in from managing radio, automation, Wi-Fi, code, and much more.
Big theme this year has been about network orchestration, managing deployments at scale, reducing the manual operations required for ever increasingly complex networks. What is augmented network automation, and what's the product that you're delivering to your customers?
Great question. So the ANA, or as you pronounce it correctly, the augmented network automation solution is quite a robust solution, which is still easy to use, to mitigate actually almost any challenge on the automation and optimization of 3G, 4G, 5G, and also now today, Aura networks deployed in most of the top tier one operators globally. The solution itself actually has more than 40 applications that mitigate all the network RAN challenges. We actually differentiate our entire platforms and applications to drive value to those operators using our AI/ML engines, which is quite a hot topic these days, right? And models that we are actually using actually create a subscriber-centric mode of making those kind of applications drive more value, more saving to the customers, while preserving the quality of experience, the SLA to the end user customers, and mitigating between the different generations when you jump from 3G to 5G and so on.
So tell me a little bit more about that, like customer centricity, because this is managing the network. So how does it then in turn focus on the customer? Give me a specific example. You mentioned like RAN challenges. So give me an example of a specific challenge that this system could detect, and then how in turn that directly benefits or is focused on the end customer.
So if we go to specific to the customers, there are several kind of inputs that the system actually digests coming from the multi different vendors of the RAN equipment, from Ericsson, Nokia, Mavenir, Samsung. We are agnostic to all of those vendors, and we create a homogeneous look on the network, how it looks, how it behaves. We mitigate any challenge in the coverage, any challenge in the interfrequency relations, any kind of congestions, lack of throughput that is being promised in your service agreement, and so on. As part of the collection of data from the network, we collect both the performance, the configuration of each cell, and we also, in some cases, also collect traces from the actual handset together with crowdsourcing materials from numerous data sources. And all of that is actually aggregated into our data management layer, where we're enforcing our data filtering, our data profiling to create those kind of inputs to our applications.
So everyone loves a good origin story. Tell me a little bit more about how ANA evolved and which specific customer pain points motivated this evolution.
So we, as I've mentioned, we are deployed today in those humongous kind of operators. There are many, many challenges to those operators, you know, to save cost, to make the streamline between the different radio access technologies that I've specified. And we actually create value from the network. And this value can be monetized later on to an actual OPEX and CAPEX savings by not spawning up more base stations, reducing the need for procurement of new licensed spectrums, actually create a seamless coverage even between the clusters that are being managed separately. Our applications actually has a centralized lookout regardless of the underlying radio equipment themselves, interconnect to it using a standardized OSS IR interface, and it can retrieve and also send out actions to those macro cells in order to mitigate whether coverage is being required to be fixed or any kind of frequency congestions or PCI, which is kind of a IP of the base stations, and more and more. And we do it through an intelligent decisions. So the actual actions is, you know, you can tilt the different antennas, you can push more power into it to expose it to a higher kind of territory, like a highway, or tilt it downwards toward a metropolitan or an industrial area, like where we are right now, and make a much more higher throughput in case if required. So because, you know, UEs like ourselves, automotive car, drones, and you name it, are always moving parts, those kinds are not statically configured. We need to make an educational kind of decisions based on previous statistics or time series kind of prediction, and making those changes in a way to not affect the badly or degrade the network performance or quality of experience.
So now that we understand the solution design a little bit better and the customer impact, let's talk about your cloud transformation journey. What do you value most in cloud partners?
So I will answer that specifically to AWS because we are here, and which was our preferred first selection for our cloud journey. Among the other, you know, there are many reasons why to choose this over another, but the most important one for us that we differentiated was the great partnership program that we have seen from the AWS, and the kind of global reach out and numerous availability zones that actually helps us to first to take the solution into the cloud and make a fast reach out to those customers that could have not afford the on-prem solution, which is actually still available. The solution itself for mobile operators, they have many kind of constraints, whether governmental one or security wise, and they are pretty afraid, like an enterprise, to go to those clouds. Now, the AWS Outposts actually provided a kind of intermediate solutions to help our customer decide better that if I have a private cloud on my premise, or if I have a dedicated connection from my data center to AWS data center using a direct connect, that will help us to comply to our security regulations, to comply to GDPR or any kind of country specific privacy that we are seeing in different parts of the world. So actually, basically those two main concepts differentiated why we chose AWS over another.
You mentioned specifically AWS Outpost, one of our edge computing solutions. And for those who haven't had a chance to try Outpost directly, what did you learn that was maybe surprising or that you didn't realize at the time that perhaps other customers and partners would benefit from?
So I was actually assuming that the Outpost will be a cloud in a box, which is kind of the same thing. But it is actually extending the management layer of the AWS cloud into my on-premise. So the entire data is preserved on-prem, so no issues with latency, jitter, lack of all the network possibility for failures. All of those was remain online while I could still initiate or absorb from the cloud those native services that can support my solution.
It's that seamless extension from the cloud to the edge, as simple as a few clicks in the AWS console. You can have a subnet in an outpost, a subnet in the region, both within the same VPC, all in under 30 seconds. So absolutely agree with that. But more broadly, as you think about your cloud transformation on AWS, what did you learn?
So I'm quite familiar with the AWS solution itself. The motivation of us taking this solution, the ANA, Augmented Network Automation Solution, and offer it as a SaaS towards our customers is is for us to make a more a packaged kind of solution with a transparent pricing model. So then smaller tiers that don't have the budget to have logic in their network, they actually rely on the vendor management or application set, which is quite primitive, not so sophisticated. Yes, all the actions are the same, but making a right decision, making it monitored 24/7, this is something that even if you bring more and more RF experts to your network in the new age of 5G, which have numerous kind of base stations spread out, that makes it almost impossible to govern what will be the relation between, you know, 5G to 4G and create a fast rollout of this 5G. So our solution based in the cloud brings the mobile network operators, the MNOs, as we like to call them in short, a fast delivery solution. It can connect almost, as I mentioned, any leading vendor of the RAN equipment, and in a transparent selection between three packages, the enhanced, the standard, enhanced, and premium packages that we have. We have selected three applications, five applications, and 10 applications accordingly that can mitigate either essential kind of activities like day-to-day operations and advanced applications that are actually optimizing the existing behavior of the network. So the challenge that they have today is to do, for the RAN experts, is to do actually two main functions. First is to make sure everything works, and the second is actually to optimize it, to make it much faster, much more territorial coverage, and lastly, try to save on the OPEX and CAPEX as much as possible.
So these apps that you're mentioning, that's the value differentiator for your solution. And so I imagine that's what in turn is going to drive ROI for operators choosing to leverage this solution. Tell me a little bit more about what you expect operators to benefit from immediately from this solution, both in terms of value creation as well as cost mitigation.
Good question. So we have actually more than 40 applications divided into different pillars, and each one of them can mitigate either 3G, 4G, 5G. And those pillars can be either coverage or interfrequency problems or a relation management between the different generations. When you don't have a 5G coverage, you're actually being downgraded kind of thing to a 4G. These seamless integration that you are not even understanding with your data application or your voice applications, it's something that the network is being adapting all the time. Now, those kind of savings can be derived from lack of spawning new base stations, the need to create more and more customer retention, that you'd like them to have a best quality in your network, unlike other competitors. And this is being derived from a coverage and a throughput that is being guaranteed 24/7, wherever the customer move it with his handset. And the main differences is not just creating this application. We also entitle our customer, our operator, we call them partners. Our partners, we entitle them the access to create their own application, because every mobile operator network is different from another, you know, due to topology, due to a territory worldwide, and so on, so the type of users that are using their network. And we gave them the flex capability to create, using our own API, any new adaptation to those applications. They can create those applications and even resell it to other partners that uses the HCL software ANA platform as well. Now, the main differentiative thing between our applications and other vendor applications are, first, that we are using homegrown AI. These AI and ML models have been used in our platforms for more than 2 years now. They have shown significant additional savings, especially in one of the most attractive one is actually our intelligent dynamic energy saving, which is called IDES for short, which is a great ROI application. It is showing a premium 7 to 10% with our first gen of application of savings. That is, if I try to monetize it in a network of 10,000 cells, it is monetized to $2 million of saving energy costs. So you imagine what is the other challenge that this operator is actually facing or tackling with the ESG, the environmental, social, government standards for saving energy, becoming eco-friendly, and yet do not downgrade the quality of experience, do not affect the speeds that you are guaranteeing to your network. So I'm pretty excited about the new generation of it, because we are seeing many, many new partners and new opcos asking that specific one, because it's like putting a free panel on your house to harvest free solar power. So in our case, it's just invoke a new application. Now, the great things about those applications is that we've created a seamless migration path from our traditional containerized platform to support also the new ORAN Alliance networks. We have equipped the platform with A1, O1, and O2 interfaces, and using the R1 interface, we actually connect our radio applications called RAP to run also on other platforms, not ours. So we've become either an SMO CIRIC player, and we are also able to extract or sell our RAP application to other partners, like, for example, VMware, which we have partnered with as well.
So as we think about those core attributes of a potential partner for the solution in the cloud, what might that look like?
So as I've mentioned, the first and the immediate targets customers are all of those mid-tiers that actually, up until today, were using the basic management tools and features provided by their vendor of RAN equipment, but they could have not afford themselves with their budget to actually create an agnostical layer of management on those RAN network equipment. We are actually targeting mobile network operators that are that have a cloud strategy and are willing to go to a cloud strategy due to constraints, organizations, policy, and so on, which has at least 1,000 cells. That's the minimum kind density. It can match a big private network. It can match a tier 2 and tier 3. It is globally, okay? So it's unlike where we have our own presence and using our HCL Tech Services Group, which is huge and almost in more than 156 countries we have a presence, can actually support this kind of motivation, whether they select it to be on a private cloud of the AWS or in a public availability zones.
So looking forward, what's the next level of HCL ANA on AWS?
On AWS, yeah. So on AWS, first of all the versions that we are doing for our on-prem, we are seamlessly using them as well on the AWS cloud. Any new applications that we are delivering will be auto-populated, that's first. We are continuously enriching our AI mechanism to make even more kind of savings to the end customers. I am looking forward for those partners to harvest like double savings from the AWS hardware OPEX deduction and also our applications value to their network. So that's a double win for the joint customer. And using the AWS, we intend to enhance our more native cloud services using a managed database or a managed kind of mano to our peripherals. That's the next evolution, actually, which is on our roadmap for this year.
Fascinating discussion here today. Appreciate you sharing your story in HCL. And thanks for joining us in the AWS studio.
So exciting. Thank you for having me.